come to be met by God and to continue on this Lenten journey as we reflect on the pains and the suffering that our Lord experienced for us, that we might not be rejected by God, but that we might be accepted and invited in as his beloved children. Welcome to any guests that we might have with us here tonight. We are so glad to have you in the midst of our family. As we begin our worship, let's stand on our feet together. And we gather in the name of our great God, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, be here in the midst of us. Lead us and guide us. Open our hearts, Lord, that we might hear and that we might be changed. Amen. At this time, our reading for this evening is from Mark chapter 14, and here we find Jesus headed out to the garden, or before the high priest, and as he's there, we see Peter, or Jesus before the high priest as they interrogate him. And they led Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. And Peter had followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. and he was sitting with the guards and warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many bore false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. And some stood up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.' Yet even about this their testimony did not agree. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, 'Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?' But he remained silent and made no answer. Again the high priest asked him, 'Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?' And Jesus said, 'I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven.' And the high priest tore his garments and said, 'What further witness do we need? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?' And they all condemned him as deserving death. And some began to spit on him and to cover his face and to strike him, saying to him, 'Prophesy.' And the guards received him with blows." This is the word of our Lord. It can be easy for us as we see the events like this in the passion of our Lord to look on those who despised and rejected Jesus with condemnation. And yet, if we are to be honest, if we are true to ourselves, we have to admit that we too have rejected and despised our Lord. Through our words and our actions, we have spit in his face, mocked him, and not respected and acknowledged him as our Lord in our life. And so we come before him to confess our rejection of our Lord and to ask for his forgiveness and restoration. Join with me as I pray on our behalf as we go before our Lord in confession. Lord, in my pride, I have rejected you as my King, Lord, and Savior. My words and actions have said, "I don't need you. I can do this on my own." And yet, Lord, my life declares something very different, that I need you desperately, Lord. Forgive me for my arrogance and pride. Pour contempt on my pride, Lord, that I might be humbled and that I might see my desperate need for you, and then restore me, empower me, and lead me as your child. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And though again and again we have rejected our Lord Jesus, he does not reject us. But he was rejected on our behalf. He was despised so that we might be accepted and welcomed in to the loving presence of our Lord and Father. Know here and now, friends, that your sins are indeed forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our message song, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
When I survey
course, the basis of that song was the hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And I don't know about you, but I've been singing that hymn my entire life. And when I found out I was preaching on it, the one phrase that kept going over and over and over in my mind was, and pour contempt on all my pride. Let's pray. Father, teach us how and give us the courage to pour contempt on all our pride. In Jesus' name, amen. So the season of Lent is a time to prepare ourselves to understand and to receive the resurrection of Jesus with fresh eyes and open hearts. So I decided that I was going to use my assigned hymns for Lent as inspiration and the Old Testament as illustration for how we can still prepare our hearts and minds to receive Jesus again this Easter, maybe in a way we hadn't before. So I want to begin by showing you, of all things, a Taiwanese insurance video, okay? I mean, I scour the globe for you guys, all right? But I promise you, this is a video that almost made me cry, and I just am not a big crier. It tells the story of a deaf-mute father and his very struggling daughter. Let's watch this.
พ่อที่ไม่เป็นใบ้พ่อที่เหมือนคนอื่นพ่อที่ได้ยินในสิ่งที่หนูอยากบอกพ่อที่พูดได้แล้วก็เข้าใจหนูได้
How tragic is it that that young lady rejected her father after all that he had done for her, because all that she could think about was that he was deaf and mute? Have you ever been rejected? That team, that girl, that boy, that school, that job you always wanted? Do you remember how it felt? The hurt, the anger, the embarrassment, feeling all alone? There's no pain quite as exquisite as the pain of rejection. So imagine how God felt on the day that Israel rejected him as king in favor of some earthly king. After all that he had done for them, he made covenants with them. He had set them free from slavery. He wandered with them in a wilderness for 40 years. He gave them the promised land. When I think about pride in the Bible, I think about King Saul. Now, this is not King Saul, but his story is found in 1 Samuel. I'm going to give you a quick overview of 1 Samuel here. You see, we meet Samuel when he's a little boy, right before he has this famous encounter with God. Samuel, because he was the firstborn, he was dedicated to the Lord. And so he was dedicated by his parents to be a priest, which meant that every once in a while he had to spend some nights in the temple and help out. And one night when he was sleeping in the temple, he was awoken two times by the Lord. But he thought it was the high priest Eli, who's this other guy over here. And so he went to Eli and he said, "What do you want?" And finally, after the second time, Eli figures out that it's the Lord. And he tells Samuel, "Next time this happens, say, 'Speak, Lord. Your servant listens.'" And so, of course, the Lord wakes him up a third time, and Samuel says, "Speak, Lord. Your servant listens." And God tells him some things that he didn't really want to hear. So the next morning, he's kind of making himself scarce, but Eli finally corners him, and he says, "You got to tell me what God told you last night." And so Samuel looks at him, and he tells him, and he says, "Eli, you're going down, man, because of the wickedness of your sons." And that's Samuel telling Eli the bad news right here. And this is how Samuel begins his prophetic ministry. And Samuel is a phenomenal prophet. He's a prophet, a priest, and he's the judge of Israel. In fact, he's the last judge that Israel ever has. He is great, but his kids are a mess. So when it comes time to figure out what's going to happen after Samuel's gone, Israel starts to get a little bit antsy. Many of you might remember what it was like when Pastor Ray was getting ready to retire. And then all of a sudden, Pastor Rob up and leaves and takes the call and goes somewhere else. And you thought, "Oh man, I sure hope God doesn't give us somebody lousy," right? And that's exactly how Israel felt. And so God gives you an alcoholic with terminal cancer, but there you go, right? But rather than trust that God would provide, they look at all the other nations and they decide that they want what everybody else has. They want a king. And this is a tragic decision with lasting consequences. For the rest of Israel's history, this one decision leads to 1,000 years of trouble. You see, bad things happen when God's people reject him and when they decide that they're going to live like the rest of the world. It was true then, and it is more true now than ever. 1 Samuel helps us understand four things about rejecting God. First of all, it helps us understand the cause. Why do we reject God? Secondly, it helps us understand the cruelty of rejecting God. Thirdly, it tells us the cost of rejecting God. And finally, it shows us the cure for rejecting God. But let's look at why we do it. Let's look at the cause of rejecting God. 1 Samuel chapter 8. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as Israel's leaders. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah, and they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not follow his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice. So the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah, and they said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." So, what caused Israel to reject God as king? Well, first of all, there was a vacuum in leadership. No one was willing to follow Samuel's kids. I mean, what happens when nobody is in charge or the wrong person is in charge. Factions form. Disunity starts to creep in. And things devolve rapidly. And the second reason that Israel rejects God as king is this: the pull of the culture. Israel's call, the whole reason God brought them into existence, was to influence the culture around them and bring people on the outside into a relationship with God. Not dump God and chase after the culture. In a couple of months, my family is going to go to New York City, and we're going to go on a Broadway show graduation trip. We're going to see 4 shows in 3 days. We are very excited. But this is not my first trip to New York City. I've been there before. And what I noticed when I was there was that there was a whole lot of culture and very little devotion to God. In many ways, places like New York City and Los Angeles and Chicago, they set the trends for what the rest of our country aspire to be. But my friends, lots of culture and very little devotion to God is not a trend worth following. But we see it happening all around us. And I believe that this is the great battle of the American church that we are fighting right now, or not. Because so many of us who call ourselves Christians are just too comfortable to care. The only way to combat those two forces is to constantly raise up new godly leaders. And you're going to be hearing a whole lot more about this throughout the year as we roll out Change the World 2020. This concept is so new, we don't even have a good logo for it yet, but we're working on it. Over the next 2 years, we are going to be transitioning away from our focus on buildings, and we are going to focus our attention on two things. Number one, every member of every age is going to be engaged in giving gospel nudges to their family, friends, and neighbors. And the second thing we are going to focus on is we are going to discover, develop, and deploy leaders at all levels of ministry for the sake of our city and the glory of God. Praise the Lord. Because raising up the next generation of godly leaders is the only way that we will crown God as king in our church, in our homes, and in this community that we love and that we seek to change. So, the cause of rejecting God is no leadership and chasing after the culture. For a moment now, let's try and understand the cruelty of rejecting God. Back to chapter 8. But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. As they have done from the day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me, serving other gods." They're just doing the same thing to you. Now, you might remember fondly the stories of King David and King Solomon in the Bible, and you might think that the kingdom of Israel was God's idea. But it wasn't. The earthly kingdom was God's concession. It wasn't his creation. The nation of Israel was the will of God, but the kingdom of Israel was not. What I want you to see is this. We don't have a cold, unfeeling God. Our God has a heart, and his heart can be broken. Genesis chapter 6, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their human heart was only evil all the time. And the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth. And his heart was deeply troubled. We have a God whose heart breaks every time one of his children rejects him in favor of sin. And parents, you get this like nobody else. Because how does your heart feel when your kids make bad choices? Or when they reject your advice? Or when they reject you? How do the words, "I hate you," feel? Feel when they're spoken by a child that you have given everything for? That's how God feels when you and I reject him. We see this never more clearly than we see Jesus when he's weeping over Jerusalem in Matthew chapter 23. And he says, "How many times have I tried to call you to myself, but you would not come?" But friends, the heart that wept over Jerusalem is the same heart that broke in the Garden of Eden and that breaks again when Israel rejects him as their king. We don't follow a cold, uncaring, distant God. We follow a God whose heart has broken for us again and again. It is cruel to reject a heart like that. The third thing that 1 Samuel helps us to understand is the cost of rejecting God. God warns them ahead of time what's going to happen. If they choose a life living for the world and their own selfish pleasure rather than living for him, he says, "Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "This is what the king who will reign over you will claim as his rights. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots and horses, and they will run in front of his chariots. Some he will assign to be commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and others to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and still others to make weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. And he will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive groves and give them to his attendants. He will take a tenth of your grain and of your vintage and give it to his officials and attendants, your male and female servants, and the best of your cattle and donkeys he will take for his own use. He will take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourself will become his slaves. When that day comes, you will cry out for relief from the king that you have chosen, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to Samuel. No, they said, "We want a king over us. Then we'll be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and go out before us and fight our battles." And when Samuel heard all that the people said, he told the Lord. And the Lord relented and gave them a king. And they got their wish. And they became just like everybody else, which is the very worst thing that can happen to a child of God. Here's a terrifying truth. God allows us to make choices, and then he lets those choices define our lives. God will never violate your free will. See, we want a God who will change the bad choices that we keep making. Or at the very least, he'll take away the consequences of the bad choices that we keep on making. But that's not the way it works. God does offer to change the heart and the mind that is making those choices, but only if we surrender. Only if we pour contempt on all our pride and crown him as king. Who's the king of your life? Let's look at who ancient Israel chose for king, all right? Kish had a son named Saul, as handsome a young man as could be found anywhere in Israel. This is one good-looking dude. And he was also a head taller than everybody else. People have an amazing way of choosing bad leaders, amen? Why? Because we place so much stock in outward appearances. Good hair, good clothes, a fat pocketbook, physically attractive, able to speak well, and at least a head taller than everybody else. I mean, that last one makes sense, but the rest of it's kind of crazy. We're just like ancient Israel. I mean, Saul was great on the outside. But on the inside, he was a mess. It only takes 4 chapters of the Bible before God's had enough and rejects him as king. After Israel defeats the Amalekites, Saul got greedy, and he kept a bunch of the good stuff for himself that he was supposed to destroy. And then he lied about it. And then he blamed it on other people. And ever since then, being a greedy liar who blames others has been the hallmark of a politician. Come on, that was pretty good. I worked hard on that one. Thank you. As God is selecting the next king, David, we see the criteria that's important to him when selecting leaders. Chapter 16. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." God is looking for people after his own heart. In America, every few years we get together and say, "Let's get rid of these bozos." And then we elect a new batch of saviors who almost immediately turn into bozos. Amen. But the problem is that we elect them based on outward appearances and what our itching ears want to hear, rather than on hearts that are devoted to God. 21st century America would never elect Jesus Christ to be president, because he would always be seeking God's will, and then he would make the rest of us start doing God's will. Why, I believe we would crucify him. God is looking for hearts full of love and people of character who are willing to lead others to him. He's looking for people after his own heart. Are you one of those people? Let's finish our video.
บางทีอาจจะไม่มีพ่อที่ดีที่สุดแต่มีพ่อที่รักคุณมากที่สุด
Video only got one thing wrong. There is one perfect father. And he is looking for people after his own heart who will lead this world back to him. And God isn't always what we want him to be. He can sometimes seem deaf and mute. But he only seems that way, my friends. Because we're the ones who don't listen. We're the ones who failed to ask. He spoke to us, and he still speaks to us through his only son, Jesus Christ. You see, 1,000 years after Israel rejected God as king, the King of Kings returned to claim his kingdom. We've seen the cause of rejection. We've seen the cruelty of it, and we've seen the cost of rejecting God. Now let's look at the cure. Jesus points the way to the cure. He began his earthly ministry by proclaiming, "The kingdom of God is here." And in many of his parables, he said things like, "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, or a pearl of great price, or a net, or a tree." Jesus is trying to reveal to us a couple of things about this kingdom of God. First of all, that the kingdom is real. That it is more real than the reality that we call real. Your life will never be changed, and Jesus will never be your true king unless you grasp that his reality is the ultimate reality. This world is not a bad place where God shows up every once in a while and does good things. This world is God's place. It always has been, and it works according to his rules. His kingdom can be our great reality, and it comes in and through people who realize that God is still reigning. And the second thing that Jesus reveals about the kingdom is that his kingdom is different. It's not a kingdom of power and greed and outward appearance. So many times we try and follow Jesus like we try and do everything else based on looks and what's in it for us. But his kingdom is a kingdom of the heart. It's a kingdom of inner transformation. And repentance is the cure for rejecting God. Repentance literally means to turn around, to change your heart, to change your mind, accepting that reality is his way and not ours. In our pride, we get caught up believing that we call the shots and make the rules. But Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one who makes things right, and we can't be right without him. And he's inviting us to surrender and allow ourselves to be more and more the people that he made us through faith and baptism. Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. All-knowing, all-loving, all-powerful, and he wants to reign supreme in your heart. He wants to pour his whole life into you. But he can only do it if we pour contempt on all our pride. This is what the King of Kings thinks about pride. What kingdom are you living for? Which king has domain over your heart? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you thought so little of pride that you humbled yourself completely. giving up the heavenly realms, taking on our flesh, and dying cursed on a cross. Help us to deflate our egos, Lord. Help us to pour contempt on our pride and humbly follow you into the lives that you ordained for us to live. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everybody said,
we continue our worship as we worship our Lord with the giving of our offerings, a showing of our love to him in response to all that he has done for us. So join us, we join together as we worship the Lord with the giving of our offerings. Invite you to stand as we join together in prayer. Lord Jesus, you gave it all for us. You gave up your heavenly throne to come down and be one of us. You gave your life, a perfect life, for us. You gave yourself into death and into condemnation. You experienced hell itself for us, that we might have a way, Lord, to come to our loving Heavenly Father, that we might see His great love that never ends for us, and that we might have the blessed right to be called children, beloved children of God. Thank you, Jesus, for laying it all down for us. Help us to live our lives each and every day as the children of God that you have made us to be. Help us to live as members of your kingdom, Lord, as your servants, going forth to be your ambassadors to this world. May we be bright and shining lights to the world, our community around us, Lord, that we might be bold and courageous as your witnesses, Lord, even to the point of suffering for your behalf, Lord. And may your kingdom be built here in our community. Lord, we lift up to you all our brothers and sisters who are suffering right now, whether it be in their bodies, in their minds, Lord, in their hearts, their souls, Lord. We pray that you would comfort them, that you would bring healing and restoration where it is needed, Lord, that you will sustain and strengthen them, Lord. Meet them where they are. Show them your love and your presence, and may it give them rest and peace. All these things, Lord Jesus, we pray in your mighty and powerful name. And we pray that prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Let's sing. Go in peace and serve the Lord.